My name is Tom Gaze. I'm director of the Rockefeller Institute. And I'd like to thank the National Press Club. I'd like to thank our wonderful panelists. And I also like to thank Bob Bullock, Michelle Charbonneau, and the rest of the Rockefeller Institute staff to help put everything together. Today's event is going to highlight a new report, State Revenues from Gambling, Short-Term Relief, Long-Term Disappointment, by Dr. Lucy Dadayan, one of our research scientists at the Rockefeller Institute. I mean, there's no doubt, just to put it in context, there's no doubt that that states have been facing a hard time lately in terms of their revenues. We've had pretty significant economic growth, but especially the sales taxes, corporate income taxes, and other sources of typical revenue have not been growing proportionately since the Great Recession. At the same time, states are facing a lot of pressure on the expenditure side with public employee pension contributions, as well as health care contributions and health care coverage. The not to speak of the deteriorating infrastructure. So given those kinds of pressures, it's not unreasonable that states are starting to look for other kinds of revenue. And as Dr. Dadayan will point out, gambling has been one of the areas in which states have been looking at. But there's a lot of issues about whether there's what are the returns, what are the likely fiscal returns of gambling expansions, as well as the net positive and negative results of or effects of gambling from a social and economic point of view. So what we're going to do is first start off with Dr. Dadayan's presentation, and we will have that will go on for about 20 minutes, and we're going to have two panels. After her presentation, the first panel will be some national experts in this issue. It will deal with a number of questions, such as how do states assess these issues of competition, saturation, and other matters that come up in making decisions about whether to expand their gambling activities. How do states use state revenues from gambling? What they should and how they can share these revenues with local governments. And also, what's the nature of the industries and their regulatory environment and the consequences of that for the for states and cities? Then we're going to have a second panel from three states, Illinois, with representatives of three states who have been on the ground and having to deal with a lot of the implementation issues and the economic issues in Illinois, in New Jersey, as well as in Massachusetts. So, although we have a lot of excellent panelists, they can go on for a long time. We're going to try to keep the presentations relatively short, but we will be putting up on our website after this is all done, probably by the end of the week, Friday, or at the very latest on Monday, all their presentations at the Rockefeller Institute's website, which is www.rockinst.org, R-O-C-K-I-N-S-T. I hope everybody enjoys going to our website. So everybody can stay in, stay on time. If you do, however, have questions, and one of the things we want to keep the presentation short is to allow questions from the audience, we will ask you to write them on a card. I think, Bob, will you be putting out the cards around to everybody? And then I will be reading those cards and reading the questions to our panelists. And there should be a fair amount of time for questions from the audience. So let me just briefly introduce our author, Lucy Dadayan. Lucy's a research scientist at the Rockefeller Institute. She's been working with us since 2001. She's written mostly in our fiscal policy area. She does her quarterly reports. She's written on state revenues with a She's written a wide variety of issues on state revenues, but she's also looked at local revenues, including a very good report recently on property taxes. She's looked at business tax credits. She's worked on spending on social programs and fiscal federalism, a wide variety of areas, as well as the topic today on gambling and sin taxes. Lucy's a wonderful analyst, to put it bluntly. She's actually one of the best analysts we've had in the history of the Institute. Lucy is an extremely careful person in dealing with data. I always believe Lucy's data. She has checked it out thoroughly before she does anything, but she's also a very thoughtful, insightful analyst in seeing patterns in the data. So she has a doctorate in informatics from the University of Albany, master's in public administration from the same university, and a bachelor's in sociology from Yerevan State University in Armenia. So so now, Lucy Dadayan. Thank you.
Good afternoon, everyone. Thank you very much for your presence. Before I start my presentation, I would like to first and foremost to thank Rockefeller Institute, particularly Tom Case, Dan Boyd, and Bob Bullock for their guidance throughout the research and writing of the report. I would also like to thank our panelists for graciously agreeing to come and present their perspectives on the impact of the gambling on state budgets, as well as to thank each of you for taking time from your busy schedules and being here. I hope the forum will be very informative for you, and without further ado, I'll start the presentation. So, gambling has become very famous, particularly in the during the time of the Great Recession. It's actually, we have seen expansion of gambling during the economic downturns, and when the state revenues are depressed, states usually turn into gambling. During the 1970s and 1980 recessions, we have seen a large expansion of lottery revenues, lottery legalization, and in the last three recessions, we have seen states turning into expansion, legalization of casinos and racinos. So since fiscal year 2008, that's the year when the Great Recession started, we had a number of states that have turned into gambling. Two states, Arkansas and Wyoming, have legalized the lottery operations. Seven states had legalized the casino operations. Three states had legalized the casino operations. And of course, the expansion legalization of casinos and racinos led to large increases in revenues in both states at the expense of leading to decreases in the states that already had casino and racino operations. And we have seen that when you have legalization of casinos and racinos, it leads to stiff competition between the states. And 8 years after the recession is over, we are still seeing states trying to expand more of casinos and racinos. Just in 2016, there were three states that had ballot measures, and the only ballot measure that was passed was in Rhode Island to open a new casino. And there was also a measure in New Jersey and Massachusetts, which was not passed, but I'm not going to talk about that because we have panelists from both states, and I'll let them to discuss that. So while states are talking a lot about legalization of casinos and racinos, lotteries still plays the biggest role in the pie of the gambling. About two-thirds of all revenue comes from lottery. And whenever I say revenues in throughout this presentation, I am actually referring to revenues going to state and local governments, that is tax revenues or other forms of revenues in the forms of fees. And casinos represent only about 19%, and racinos are at 12%. Now, parimutuels used to be, they are the most, the longest standing form of gambling activity. And as you can see, the parimutuels represent less than 0.5% of the total pie. So there has been a lot of substitution between different forms of gambling activities. In this table, you will see the number of states that have different forms of gambling. And you can see that a lot of states had legalized lotteries before 1990, around 32 states. And the casinos and racinos have been coming to existence since 1990s. And in the Great Recession, in here, you can see that there are seven states that had legalized casinos. It's operational in six states, and New York had legalized, but it's still not operational. So this chart shows the inflation-adjusted state and local government revenues from various types of gambling activities. The red line on the top is the subtotal of different types. The blue line is the lottery. Green line is casino, orange is racino, and purple line is actually Indian casinos. But we don't have comprehensive data for all Indian casinos. We were able to collect only for seven states, which actually represent about over 50% of total Indian casino revenues. So you can see that despite the growth in the number of states that had legalized casinos, the revenues haven't seen much growth, from $27.7 billion in 2008 to around $28 billion in 2015. So there was a lot of expansion of gambling activities, but not that much growth in gambling revenues. Now, let's compare to gambling revenue to tax revenues. This chart is a little bit crowded. I'll try to explain as clearly as I can. The red bars are the nominal growth rate, percent change in tax revenues from state government tax revenues. This excludes the local government tax revenues. So you can see that in fiscal year 2008-2009, the state government tax revenues have seen large declines at 8.5%. For the first time, we have seen decline in the revenues from casinos, racinos, and lottery as well. The blue bars show the tax revenues, tax and fee revenues from lottery, casino, and racino. And the green bars is the same, but excludes the states that had legalized casino, racino, or lottery activities since fiscal year 2008. So in other words, the green bars exclude data for Arkansas and Wyoming. The blue line, it also excludes data for new casino states such as Maryland, Ohio, Pennsylvania, as well as excludes new states that had legalized racinos, which is Indiana, Maryland, and Ohio. So the next year, in fiscal year 2010, state government taxes still saw some declines, but we see rebounding of government tax revenues. Fiscal year 2011, strong growth in tax revenues, but really, really weak growth in total gambling revenues and declines in the gambling revenues for the older states, the states that had operations of gambling activities for a long time. In fiscal year 2008, we suddenly see large growth in gambling revenue, but that's exclusively due to opening of new casinos, 20 new casinos, as well as three new racinos. Now, in 2013, we see quite difference between the growth rates of tax revenues and gambling revenue. Total tax revenues grew by 6.1%, while the gambling revenues saw much weaker growth. And that's the 2014. We actually see declining growth in tax gambling tax revenues, and same thing is in 2015. So the growth rates, the overall picture shows that the growth rates in tax revenues from gambling activities did not keep up with the growth rates in total state government tax rates, and for at least for the last 3 years. Now let's turn to lotteries. The following map shows the lottery timeline. You can see that the darker blue shaded states are the states, the early adopter states, and the green ones are the ones that have adopted lottery operations since 2001. So you can see that it all started in the northeast, moved towards the west, and went to the south. Lotteries usually are regulated and operated by state governments, with the exception of Wyoming, where it's a quasi-governmental entity. The gross revenue from lotteries is usually allocated among the lottery administrators paying prices as well as to transfer to the state funds. There is not much variation among the states. Usually states transfer between 20 to 30% of the proceeds to the state funds, and the big outliers are South Dakota and Oregon, where they transfer 74% for South Dakota and 49% for Oregon. In this chart, we show the compound annual growth rates for lottery by region between 2008 and 2015. We see that there is a huge variation among regions. The regions in the northeast, in the New England plains, and pretty much everywhere in the country, with the exception of southeast and southwest, have seen declines between 2008 and 2015. For the nation as a whole, it was around 0%, not much change, and the growth was mostly observed in the southwest and southeast at 0.8 and 1.4%. Now let's turn into casinos and racinos. For this report, we have tracked down the opening date of each single casino outside of Nevada and South Dakota. Nevada, because we couldn't find comprehensive data for over 270 casinos, and South Dakota as well, we couldn't find good data. So the chart, the table in here shows that before 1990, there were really only seven casinos outside of Nevada and South Dakota. So the growth of casino and racino facilities grew after 2000, in the last decade. You can see that after 2006, between 2006 and 2015, we have 50 new facilities, which represents about one-third of total casinos. We have 33 new racinos, which represent over 50% of total racino facilities. So about 50% was opened after 2006. So the growth in casinos and racinos became really popular after the great, around the Great Recession area. And where are the casinos and racinos located in the nation? So the colors in here are not very clear. I don't know why, but there are seven states that have both types of casinos and racinos, both types of gambling activities, casinos and racinos. So the red dots in here are showing the locations of the casinos. The blue dots are the locations of the racinos. And this chart excludes the Indian casinos. We also don't show the locations for Nevada, because they are highly concentrated and impossible to get addresses for all 270 states, as well as for South Dakota, we simply couldn't find data. You can see that in most other cases, the casinos and racinos are located across the border lines, and you can see that there are also highly concentrated along the Mississippi River. Here. Now, I wasn't going to show you this chart because I'm still working on it, trying to make sure everything is accurate in here. But in here, we say, okay, there are not many casinos in the West Coast, but actually there are many casinos in the West Coast. This is showing the locations of the Indian casinos in the nation. And you can see that the states that don't have casinos in this chart actually do have Indian casinos, which oftentimes operate just like any regular commercial casino in the states. So we looked at the casino and casino tax revenues among the regions. So the following chart shows the cumulative percent change in inflation-adjusted revenues for casinos and casinos combined. And you can see that since fiscal year 2008, the revenues are actually still below the pre-recession levels for the Midwest and Western states, the blue line and the green line. It's slightly above the pre-recession levels for the South. However, that is caused by the opening of new casinos in Maryland. Maryland is a state that has legalized casino operations just recently, around fiscal year 2008, I believe, and after the Great Recession. So that's attributable to Maryland. The northeastern states have seen dramatic growth between fiscal year 2008 to 2013, when we see some slowing down in the growth of the revenues in the northeastern states. So the growth in northeastern states is attributable to a single state, Pennsylvania, which had legalized and opened commercial casinos and casinos starting fiscal year 2008. And it's also attributable to a single casino location located in New York City. We drop those two, and we see declines again. In this chart, I show the same thing, but I divide the states into two groups, all the states and the states that, and I exclude in the blue line, I exclude just three states, Kansas, Maryland, and Ohio, because all three states had legalized commercial casinos and casinos in the past, since fiscal year 2008. And when you drop just three states, you still include New York City casino and you include Pennsylvania casinos and casinos, you see that the early adopter states have seen large declines. They didn't see actually any growth in terms of cumulative percent change since fiscal year 2008. Now, there is wide variation among the states in terms of casino tax rates. And in here, the states are ranked based on the legalization date, which the first state to legalize casino operations was Nevada in 1931. You can see that where tax types are either flat or graduated. What is most important to see in this table is that the late adopter states have much higher tax rates on casinos. It can be as high as 55% in Pennsylvania, and it's as low as 0.25% in Colorado. Now, in addition to tax rates, states also often charge admission fee or some other fees, as well as they charge separate tax rate on table games, which is usually actually lower than the casino device rates. The only exception in this chart is Indiana and Illinois, which are early adopter states, but they have higher tax rates, and both states had a lot of legislative changes since 1990s in terms of changing their tax rates for casinos and casinos. Here we show the revenues for all casino states for fiscal year 2008 to 2015. We divide the states into two groups, older casino states and new casino states. You can see the percent change for the latest fiscal year, 2015, compared to 2014. Compound annual growth rate for between 2008 and 2015, percent change and dollar change between fiscal year 2008 and 2015. Now, what's important in here to see is that overall, for the nation as a whole, the compound annual growth rate is negative 0.2%. And it's negative 4.4% for early adopter states and positive 54.6% for the new casino states. So between 2008 and 2015, older gambling states had seen about $1.5 billion decline, while the new adopter states have seen growth of $1.4 billion. I mean, this is showing the competition between the states and the cannibalization, the substitution of the revenues from the casinos. Now we turn into racinos, and unlike in the case of casino states, racinos, the tax rates are not really tied to the legalization date. For example, Rhode Island was the first state to legalize racino operations, but it has a very high tax rate at 61% for Twin River and 59% for Newport Grand. So unlike the casino states in here, actually, some states have different tax rate for different facilities, racino facilities within the state. And the state that has low tax rates is, for example, Louisiana at 18.5%. The highest tax rate is in Maryland at 67%. Once again, we looked into the actual tax dollars generated from racino locations, and when we look at the compound annual growth rate, it's 2.5% for the nation, but we see much weaker growth for older racino states at 0.6% and large growth for newer racino states at 77%. Now, this includes the New York City. If we exclude New York City, we'll see decline in overall revenues from racinos for the nation. So, what do we learn from the doing this study is, first thing we learned that gambling is not recession-proof, that gambling expansion brings in more revenue until we see a saturation point. Some new revenue represents a shift, and it's not representing a net growth. And if history is of any lesson, then we know that the revenues from gambling will not keep up with the revenues from overall state and local government tax revenues, as well as from spending areas. So gambling in general is a very slow revenue source, and it's not a solution for closing the budget gaps. Thank you very much.
Thank you very much, Lucy. Now we're going to have a our first panel. So we would like to have John Hicks and Jackson Brainerd, Alan Mallach, and Norton Francis come up here and grace our table. What we're going to do, we do have a list of, we have a very good panel. I mean, these really, we brought together in both panels, the experts nationally in this area. So this is a great opportunity to find out everything you want to know about this topic. We do have a handout with the bios, so I'm not going to go through their extensive biographies. John Hicks is executive director of the National Association of State Budget Office, Budget Officers, I'm sorry, NASBO, as we like to call it. Jackson Brainerd is a policy associate at the Fiscal Affairs Program of the National Conference of State Legislatures. Alan Mallach is senior fellow at the Center for Community Progress, and Norton Francis is senior research associate at the Urban Institute. I would like, in that order, John, Jackson, Allen, and Norton to speak. Again, we're going to try to keep the presentations down to about 10 minutes, so there'll be plenty of time for discussion afterwards. So, John, want to get started? Thank you.
Thank you, Tom. Sure, no problem. Well, thank you. First, I want to say a big thank you to Lucy and Rockefeller Institute. This is a wonderful paper, and anytime we get to see a historical information on all 50 states on a key fiscal policy question, at the National Association of State Budget Officers, we devour that type of information. So let me see if I can work this right. I'm going to briefly go over a few points, and again, the PowerPoint will be available later. But I want to talk about the uniqueness of gaming revenues. I come from the Commonwealth of Kentucky, and we use the more southern term gaming instead of gambling. To talk about the issues in estimating those revenues and in budgeting for those revenues, and then what's next. What's unique about gaming revenues? You had to vote for it. Very few of you voted for a sales tax or an income tax because your constitutions didn't prohibit those things. They told your legislatures, raise taxes to accommodate their appropriations. In the 1820s, basically, most states' constitutions were changed so that you couldn't have lotteries. You couldn't have gambling. And so in order to have it, states had to vote for it. So what's unique about this revenue stream is the way that it came about. And what's also different about it is a lot of states, most states, kind of put a little sweetener there. I'll give you a little candy if you'll vote for the lottery. What was that candy? That candy was a dedicated use of the money. We'll give it to education, or we'll give it to scholarship programs, or we'll share it with local governments. That didn't happen with most tax policy. And then Lucy's paper does a good job of states are copycats. Never underestimate the power of envy when states look at one another. And so lotteries spread across the United States like shadows at dusk. And she just showed you, the timeline. Estimating gaming revenues in the world of state budgets, that's half the battle, is how much money do we have to spend? And so it's a very arduous, interesting, complex process of estimating revenues. Gaming revenues are unlike estimating sales taxes and income taxes and corporation income taxes, where history teaches us most of the lessons along with macroeconomic indicators. In the world of gaming, you've got to know more about the gaming industry itself. You've got to know about your neighbors, the border states. You've got to understand the implications between substitutions of entertainment dollars, even lottery against casinos. It is volatile. In that the data don't behave well, you don't have a nice trend line of individual income tax revenues to base your estimate off of. There are a lot of other variables, so people who do a good job at estimating gaming revenues do it because they know gaming, because they understand the implications of the gaming industry in their region against their neighbors. Another thing that's interesting is the governance structures of lottery boards, we've got some on the next panel, and gaming boards, they're a little bit different. Sometimes they're not always cooperative when it comes to estimating how much are we going to have next year, Joe? Well, Joe has his own interests at the gaming board about how much to offer up, because what is the one thing that a lottery board does not want to be is under the budgeted estimate of their revenues. They would rather under-promise and over-deliver, because that's their self-interest. So that doesn't happen in the income tax. Something else that's been, just a trend, and I don't have the data, but I have anecdotal, is when new casinos come online, states adopt casinos, there's a tendency initially to overstate the revenues, overstating the benefits. So whether that's upselling the idea or whether it's truly just a miss on the estimate. Gaming revenues, as the report says, about $28 billion for us in the 50 states. but now let me depress that. That's only about 2% of states' own money. You know, so gaming can't be an answer to big questions, but it's still a very important, there's something I used to tell my young budget analysts all the time. The most important million is the last million in doing budgets. And so while the numbers aren't huge, they're very important to $100 million in a $10 billion budget buys a lot of important things. And so something else that happens when states adopt new gaming revenues, typically because of the uncertainty of the numbers, they'll often budget one-time uses for the initial burst of funds versus the ongoing, because there's an I don't know, how long will it take to get them up, the administration and execution of it takes some time. So often states will kind of, they'll sweeten the pot initially with good reason. Because of the uncertainty, they will put some one-time things on there. Now, budgeting for that, and I've only got a couple of minutes left, a lot of the lottery and casino gamings are dedicated to purpose. Public education probably leads the league. Scholarships, people have heard about the Georgia Hope Scholarship as probably being the first state where a merit scholarship program was entirely dependent upon lottery revenues. Local governments and the share of that. Thank you, Bob. But then there are some states that don't dedicate it. They toss it into the general fund and let their Republican Democratic institutions work. They let their elected officials decide. State budget officers prefer this. We don't like our governors to have to do something. We prefer they choose to do something. So dedicated funds is a complexity in state budgeting, and gaming revenues are typically dedicated. This issue of are we better off because we had gaming for education? This issue of fungibility of the money, did it supplement or did it supplant or replace? Did it substitute? That's not so easy to determine. I've seen a number of academic studies, but it's just not easy to tell. And in tough fiscal times, what it does is probably protects education from cuts or minor growth in other spending, rather than a total replacement. And so it becomes a feature of the way we fund education. It's just another fund source. But there are some things at risk there. I mentioned the Hope Scholarship as one example in Georgia. If you devote most or all of your lottery proceeds to one program and that's its primary funding source, that program is at risk when the funds don't come in sufficient or when eligibility exceeds the sufficiency of the revenue. So when you isolate it, there's more risk than when you spread it out. Education's a better example of the latter. Education's funded multiple ways: state general fund revenues, local property taxes typically, and gaming revenues can be that third piece, small, but still an additional piece at the time it was adopted. I'm going to skip around to here. This issue of reliability and predictability. The issue, predictability is more important. If you can predict it, then the reliability kind of melts away. The issue is whether you can predict it. Sustainability, I think Lucy's done a good job of talking about the aging of gaming, the intrastate competition, the substitution. It's not going anywhere. It will be around and it will stay around. So it's sustainable to a point. And the shrinking shares, I think as you saw, is more a function of where you live in this country. There are some states on there that were white that when they adopt casino gambling, their revenues are going way up at the expense of their neighbor. Will there be more gaming in order to get more revenue? Definitely. And I'll stop right there. Thank you.
Hello all, I'm Jackson Brainerd. Just want to start out by thanking Lucy and the Rockefeller Institute for having me out here to talk about trends in state gaming. So This is the state of the states with regard to commercial casino and lottery legality. As Lucy's report mentioned, states have been gradually expanding gaming operations over the years. Today, only Hawaii and Utah do not have some form of legal gambling. But as far as 2016 was concerned, it wasn't a terribly busy year. The recent election saw three states with ballot measures related to gambling, and only Rhode Island passed a measure. As far as 2016 legislative sessions were concerned, eight states proposed casino-style expansion of some sort, whether it be new casino or riverboat licenses or expanding casino-style gaming to racetracks. On the lottery front, three of the six states that don't have lotteries proposed one. None of them passed. And since most states have lotteries, a lot of the activity there is focused on expanding the availability of purchases, ease of access. Ohio and Iowa both passed measures to increase the number of self-service kiosks throughout the state. Florida proposed a measure to allow people to purchase lottery tickets over the by credit card. And this is the increasing accessibility of gaming opportunities has a lot to do with millennial engagement. That generation just isn't gambling as much as others. Data indicates that they're not participating in lotteries as much. They don't play the slots as much. So a shift to more interactive gaming is occurring in casinos, table games replacing slot machines. Three states have passed measures encouraging casinos to invest in more, the term is hybrid games, more interactive type video games. Louisiana passed a measure encouraging casinos to invest in non-gambling developments for things like restaurants that'll bring people in for other reasons. And a lot of this also plays into getting gambling opportunities available over the web. Online gaming came on the scene about 5 years ago when the Department of Justice ruled it legal. But since then, states have not been quick to legalize and regulate it. It's still only legal in three states. About seven states proposed in 2015, six states proposed measures this year. The slow growth is partially due, you've got your traditional opposition that says the social costs aren't worth it, which is a perennial counter argument against gaming, but you've also got powerful casino interests, Sheldon Adelson, Sands, who would like the federal government to crack down on internet gaming, and there's been legislation proposed with this goal in mind. So that's kind of had a bit of a stifling effect. In terms of revenue, coming out of the gates, online lottery had some lofty projections. Governor Christie's office in New Jersey projected that would bring in about $1 billion in its first year. But for the states that have legalized it, it hasn't been quite that exciting. Delaware took in below 400,000 in 2015. Nevada stopped reporting online revenues, but one of their three online poker dealers shut down, citing weak revenues. New Jersey has been reaping some benefits from online gaming. They're bringing in about 15 to 17 million over the last few months, but that's not quite what was promised. So right now it's looking like more of a buffering revenue stream than a true windfall. And that seems to be the case for online lotteries. Several states are now selling tickets over the internet or offering more interactive online lottery games over the web. As far as revenues go, the Kentucky Lottery forecast about $7 million for the next fiscal year. Michigan's estimated about $60 million from iLottery services. And there is something to be said for the increased convenience. Georgia authorized an online lottery in 2012, and by 2014, about a third of their purchases were being made over the web, and gross sales have been growing annually about 8.6% from 2015 to 2016. States have been much quicker to address the legalization and regulation of daily fantasy sports, which really came onto the scene in a big way in 2015 after a big advertising blitz by the two big operators, DraftKings and FanDuel. Fantasy sports operators have pulled out of a number of states, citing either because the legal atmosphere is uncertain or they've been labeled illegal gambling. That's a big part of the debate. Is it a legal game of skill or an illegal game of chance? Nine states have now passed legislation to legalize to legalize daily fantasy sports. 35 states proposed DFS-related legislation this year. And as far as revenues go, what does it mean for state budgets? Because there have been lofty projections accompanying the Daily Fantasy Sports Talk. Projections for the market range from about 8 to 14 billion in entry fees by 2020. So you factor in taxes on that, and it's a few billion nationwide. Missouri's Gaming Commission estimates that a tax on DFS operators would bring in about 600,000 annually. Andrew Cuomo's office estimated about 4 million. So it's a new market, and who knows what the growth potential is. But right now, it's not quite looking like the like a true panacea for new gaming opportunities. And piggybacking off of that, sports betting is still illegal under the Professional and Amateur Sports Protection Act, except for the four states that were allowed to keep existing operations when it was enacted. But other states would like to get in. New Jersey passed a measure in 2014 to legalize sports betting and challenge PASPA, and that was recently struck down by the Third Circuit Court of Appeals. This year, California and New York proposed measures that would provide for the legalization of sports betting, and Pennsylvania passed a resolution encouraging the federal government to lift the ban. So you can see what it's appealing about. 38% of Americans report betting on sports in some fashion annually. There have been very lofty projections about the size of the sports underground sports betting market in the billions of dollars. A London-based firm estimated that in the United States it could bring in about $11.9 billion annual total. So again, like fantasy sports, a tax on that, you're looking at a few billion dollars. And to put it into perspective, Nevada, a state where sports betting is legal, there they made about, sports bookmakers took in $230 or so million dollars in 2015. And you compare that to the $11.1 billion in total casino revenues, and it's a smaller slice. So that's a brief lay of the land. Revenue's flattening. There are a lot of new opportunities, and whether the social costs associated with that expansion is being gradually decided. The new opportunities appear to provide a helpful revenue stream for existing gaming revenues, but to the extent which they can be a stabilizing force for budgets overall is a bit more hazy.
Well, delighted to be here, and I'd like to thank the Rockefeller Institute for sponsoring this program. And I'd like to both talk about some of the larger issues involved with looking at economic and fiscal impacts of casinos, and then zoom in on New Jersey as a case study that illustrates some of the key issues involved. Okay, first thing is where I'm starting from, and this is fascinating. Casinos, even though I suspect the moral disapproval of gambling is significantly less today in the United States than it was maybe 10, 20, 30, 40 years ago, the fact is that in the abstract, casinos are seen as an economically desirable but socially or morally questionable activity, which has led to a unique regulatory environment. I cannot think of another sector of the American economy that is similar as a highly regulated, quasi-monopolistic, state-sanctioned, licensed industry. It's quite unusual in that respect. The only exception is Nevada, where casinos are treated more or less as just a normal part of the state economy. And there are significant implications for this unique status, which I'll get to. The other thing is that they create a lot of different economic costs and benefits that are not always that well understood, either by state policymakers, advocates, or opponents. So what some of those are, the first thing is that each individual casino, typically, is a major economic engine. It generates a lot of money, it employs a lot of people, which means that it can be seen by state policymakers as the economic equivalent of a magic bean. Unlike the cumulative effect of hundreds of small businesses or manufacturing growth, which is essentially under the radar in that sense. But in terms of that, the effects can vary enormously, depending most significantly on the geographic distribution of the gamblers and the geographic distribution of the workforce, the owners, the operators, the vendors, and so forth. So the best case, and I'll jump to the best case, is this. The gamblers come from outside the area, but the workforce is local. This is pretty close to the Las Vegas model, which actually is by far, in my opinion, the best case in the United States from the standpoint of sustainable economic effects of gambling. The gamblers fly in, so what that means is that now, gambling has no value added, which means every dollar spent in gambling is substituted by a dollar that's not spent someplace else. So what this means is that all the substitution in the money that's spent in the Las Vegas casinos is taking place in California, in Illinois, in Texas, in China, in Hong Kong, wherever. It's not taking place in Vegas. And what's interesting is a very large percentage of the population of the Vegas area is LDS, who are not supposed to gamble by their religion. So, however, the entire workforce, for all practical purposes, lives in that area. So all of the multipliers are maintained in the local area, and it maximizes benefit. By contrast, and I would say Detroit is probably a pretty good example of the opposite end. Virtually all of the gamblers who frequent the casinos in Detroit are residents of either the city of Detroit or the immediate metropolitan area. However, the workforce, the ownership, the vendors, and so forth are widely dispersed. So that means that all of the substitution is taking place locally, but a very significant part of the multipliers are going to other parts of the region and other parts of the country entirely. And as I said already, I guess I got ahead of myself, all casino spending is substituting for some other spending. And of course, the other problem, which people, it's very difficult to measure, it's very difficult to pinpoint, but there is no question that there are a lot of costs associated with casino gaming, which both are social costs, but also reverberate economically because of issues of problem gambling, issues of crime. There's a debate in the industry as to whether the crime associated with casinos is or is not greater than the crime that is drawn to any facility that attracts a lot of out-of-town people. There are arguments on both sides, but the fact is it is significant. So, if you take the position that it's all substitution, why do states want casinos so badly? And this is where it goes back to this concept of a quasi-monopolistic industry. And I think this is an important thing that is not adequately addressed in the literature. If a state licenses a monopoly, the state is in a position to tax that monopoly at a much higher rate than if it's simply an openly competitive industry. And you see this in casinos. There are no other sectors of a state economy that I'm aware of that are taxed at rates comparable to casino taxation. And so, working off the tables that Lucy so wonderfully put together, I averaged out the graduated rates and found 2/3 of the states tax casinos at an average rate of 20% or higher. No state that I'm aware of has a sales tax of 20%. No state that I'm aware of has, even in the highest brackets, has an income tax of 20%. It's a unique mechanism that is only made possible because of its quasi-monopolistic character. So, the problem, and moreover, what I find is states, by and large, share very little of their gains, ill-gotten or otherwise, with local governments. In fact, most share little or none. New Jersey does not share one penny. Pennsylvania gives less money to host cities than it does to racetracks, which strikes me as not being a very good balance. The only state, in fact, that has a fair, what I would characterize as a fair balance of between state and local is Michigan, where in effect the state splits the take with the city of Detroit 50-50. Now, the problem, of course, with all of this is, as has been pointed out, the market is getting saturated. And I think Lucy's numbers about how essentially the new casino states have displaced the revenues from the older casino states while the total pot stays basically the same is very telling. The market is saturated, which means that for all practical purposes at this point and for a number of years now, every additional casino is basically taking money from other casinos, taking gamblers from other casinos, and redistributing an essentially static pot. And it's very visible. If you look at New Jersey, it's fascinating. Atlantic City, for many years, had the only casinos on the East Coast. And so it was alone. Today, this is the picture. Every one of those dots represents a major casino that is essentially competing for the same pool of gamblers as the Atlantic City casinos. Perhaps we should call them gamers, but somehow that doesn't sound quite right. Now, Pennsylvania in particular was very careful to make sure that when they brought their casinos online, they would essentially form a string of pearls roughly along the Delaware River to maximize their ability to capture out-of-state gamblers, a significant percentage of whom were people who had previously gone to Atlantic City. And they were fabulously successful, as these charts show. This is the change in Atlantic City in terms of workforce, gross revenues, and state receipts since Pennsylvania started to come online. And what's, by the way, notable with respect to, as you can see, the drop in state in receipts over the last few years has been significantly less than the drop in employees or gross revenues, something which is attributed to what Jackson pointed out was the buffering effect of the revenues being generated from internet gambling. So, what this prompted was this. Last week, we had a referendum on whether to expand gambling to North Jersey. And this, I thought this was particularly telling. I live in New Jersey, and this was a flyer that I got in the mail from the people who were proposing yes. And I love this. When we start talking about saturation and cannibalizing each other and so forth, they have stolen our gaming revenue. Now, from any logical, economic, political, sociological standpoint, that statement is utter nonsense. But the whole point was Pennsylvania took it away from Atlantic City by putting casinos in North Jersey. We'll get it back. Fortunately, at least for the moment, saner heads prevailed, and in fact, the referendum was roundly defeated. But the point is that people still keep trying. And there's no doubt that if the casinos had been approved in North Jersey and had been taxed at the high rates that were being discussed, there would have been a short-term revenue boost. However, as I think Lucy's analysis and others have shown, it would be, again, a short-term boost. And ultimately, somebody else would come, the casino in Manhattan would come, something else would happen, and ultimately things would settle back down to the status quo ante. Thank you.
Good afternoon. I don't have a presentation, so I'll just be talking to you. First, I'd like to thank the Rockefeller Institute and Lucy, Bob, and Tom for inviting me here today for this important discussion, and to thank them for publishing this report on state gaming revenues that is the most comprehensive I've seen, and it's covered a lot of important issues that we've touched on today. I also like to thank this panel. I had the unenviable task of going last after so much information has been presented, and there's probably going to be some redundancy in my presentation. So I'm glad they had slides for it. So I'm a researcher at the Urban Institute State and Local Finance Initiative, where, as the name implies, we study the finances of state and local governments, and in particular, we focus on sustainability issues. Governments at all levels need reliable and sustainable revenue to support services and programs the public demands. There are two manifestations of this sustainability that I want to talk about today. First, the state and local relationship regarding who gets the revenue from gaming. And second is the use of gaming revenue for K-12 education, which is transferred to local school districts in the states. So first up, just to give a little bit of context on the state and local relationship, the relationship between the state and local governments, for some context, the Great Recession caused significant fiscal damage at all levels of government, and one of the ways state governments have responded is by reducing revenue flows to local governments, either through a reduction in local grants or a reduction in shared revenue. According to the census from 2007 to 2012, the only years the detailed local data is available, state intergovernmental transfers to counties, cities, and towns for general government support, this is their operational spending, has declined over 15% in real terms between 2007 and 2012. The decline is broad-based, occurring in more than half the states. The National League of Cities, in its recent report on city fiscal conditions, cited declining state and federal aid as negative factors facing city budgets. But revenue sharing is an issue as well. The state and local relationship regarding revenues comes from the ability to raise revenues and the level of revenue sharing. Taxing authority for local governments come from the state statutes or the state constitution, so local governments aren't free to raise revenue as they see fit. And state policymakers can place restrictions on the level of tax allowed. We see this mostly with the property tax, though almost all local states have faced maximum local tax rates as well. In fact, the National Association of Counties just yesterday released a report looking at the ways local government revenue generating abilities are restricted. From exempting all services from tax forever, as the voters did in Missouri last week, to banning local governments from establishing plastic bag fees, as they proposed in Texas, local governments face significant challenges in crafting sustainable budgets, which is why we became interested in the gaming laws in the states. As Alan pointed out, there's very little sharing of the state gaming revenue with local governments. And I'm only going to talk about commercial casinos. Lottery is pretty much all state-level revenue. So we became interested in the gaming laws, and we're curious about how the states share the revenues with local governments and where taxing authority is given. Part of the motivation came from proposals like New Jersey's recently rejected initiative. One of the things that's interesting about that is that the proposal was to establish new casinos in the northern part of New Jersey. Outside of Atlantic City, they had to be, I think, 72 miles away from Atlantic City. And part of the revenue from those enhanced gaming would come back to Atlantic City for a short period of time. So New Atlantic City, which I believe is now in state receivership, and we're going to hear more about that later, I think, they're there because of the declining gaming, as Alan has pointed out. The interesting thing about Atlantic City, as Alan also pointed out, is that they receive no state gaming tax revenue, but they do receive significant sales, lodging, and property tax revenue that's dependent on the gaming industry. Another motivation is the Michigan arrangement with Detroit, where Detroit is the only city in Michigan where commercial casinos are allowed outside of tribal casinos. And the tax revenue contributes about 15% of the city's annual budget, which is probably the largest share of budget you're going to see from gaming revenues in local governments. Now, Lucy's paper has excellent data on revenues associated with gaming. And like I said, I'm going to limit my discussion to just the commercial casinos and racinos. One thing we have to keep in mind, though, as John pointed out, is that this is actually a pretty small amount of revenue. Particularly when we exclude lotteries, the casino racino is a very small share of the state and local pie. The tax revenues from casinos from gaming taxes on the activity of gaming, the tax revenues from casinos come from gaming taxes on the activity, but they also come from sales taxes, lodging taxes, and property taxes. And in some local areas, there's a local income tax. These are divvied up among the governments, and that formula is different in each state. For example, Detroit has its own tax on casino wagering and a property tax on casino property, but Michigan doesn't allow local sales tax. They do share a portion of the state sales tax, but they don't allow local governments to enact their own sales taxes. Atlantic City, as I said, on the other hand, gets no money from the state gaming taxes, but has local sales and lodging and property taxes. Some of these arrangements have evolved from horse and dog racing, where casino-style gaming like slot machines have been introduced. In addition to revenue, gaming at racetracks has been a boon to an industry that seemed on the verge of extinction in many states. But while local governments get about 20% of paramutual revenue, according to the census data, they likely get a lot less in new revenue from gaming. In Pennsylvania, I think the share of horse racing revenue with local governments was about 12%, while the share of casino action, the new revenue, was closer to 7%. And home governments where the tracks or casinos are located typically get some share of it to offset some of the costs associated with the facilities. In Missouri, the home dock gets 10% of the gaming revenue and a share of the admissions fees. And this is riverboat gaming, so you have to actually walk a plank, I believe, to get into the casino. That adds about $13 million or just about 1% to Kansas City's general fund. But the hometown also gets increased economic activity and hopefully tourism from casinos, although we've seen today that there's a lot of substitution effects that we have to take into account of. But particularly for towns with dying horse and dog tracks, the city gets a continuation of an important cultural industry and an important employment industry. But they also lose out in sales tax revenue that might have been spent on other transactions taxable by the local government. The states where gaming has expanded recently in Ohio and in Maryland, neither of these states have local sales taxes. So they miss out on the construction of casinos, which is, these facilities are huge facilities and there's a lot of sales tax revenue coming from the construction. But Ohio has a very good, they distribute about half of the revenue, not to the home jurisdictions, but they distribute about half the revenue to all the counties in the state, and then another third of the revenue to school districts. So now I want to move on to the K-12 education, and I'll be a lot briefer here. State and local governments spend most of their revenue on three activities: public education, higher education, and Medicaid. The pensions is a growing share of that as well. But those are the three main activities, and they consume more than half the resources of the states. So state policymakers found themselves in a conundrum of our own making. On the one hand, the public wants good quality education for children. On the other hand, they don't want to pay any more in taxes. When K-12 education is about 45% of the state general fund, and this is just the states, and it's higher in some states, increasing per pupil spending or adding programs like pre-K comes with a significant cost. So state policymakers look for ways to raise revenues without touching the broad-based taxes like income and sales. Sin is a natural because it's harder to defend. Since 2000, virtually every state has increased cigarette taxes, and the median tax rate has gone from 34 cents per pack to about $1.36. And it's no coincidence that in the same period, gaming has expanded greatly. And while revenue from cigarette taxes are usually sent to the general fund, gaming taxes have been earmarked for education in about half the states that have casino-style gaming. And so the reason I bring that point up and to wrap it up is that although casino revenues are a drop in the education spending bucket, we're not seeing any increases or dramatic increases in education revenues, which is one of the things that expansion of gaming and to a greater degree lottery revenue is sold on. And so another important issue is the declining nature of sin tax revenue. Cigarette tax revenue needs more people to smoke, which fewer and fewer are. Casino revenue needs more gamers from outside the state. And while the number of gamers may not be decreasing, the number of options available to them are, and interstate competition is fierce. So as we continue to discuss gaming and the revenues associated with it, these are two important issues that need to be part of the conversation. How local governments are partners in the gaming revenue, particularly those bearing the cost of the gaming facilities and activities, and the second, to the extent which we are tying critical expenditures like education that grow with population to declining revenue sources. Thank you.
All right, thank you very much. First, just a couple of items. If you would like to submit a question, and if you did not receive a card, please ask Bob. We'll give you a card, and he will also give me the cards once you submit the question. Also, if you haven't signed in, please do so sometime before you leave with Bob so we can keep in touch with you. Anyway, thanks everybody for a really good panel, a really good discussion. We have a few questions already. I have one question that I guess picks up really on some of the things that Alan was talking about when he was comparing these extreme cases of Las Vegas versus Detroit. Can we summarize if we wanted to give advice to whether it be state legislators, governors, or citizens who often have to vote on these issues? Under what circumstances, if any, would expansion of gaming and gambling be a relatively good idea, and under what circumstances is it a awful idea? Can the panelists sort of talk about some of the criteria that you would take into account? I mean, I know there's a lot of expansion when there is competition nearby, but is that the worst situation, or is that a reasonably good situation to try to stem some of the losses? So anybody want to talk about that?
Well,
Alan, go ahead. You already got into that subject.
Start out by what do you mean by good, what is bad? But I think, again, from a purely fiscal standpoint, if you're in a state that does not have casinos, and you are ringed by other states that do have casinos, and you have a major city with a substantial workforce and institutional and vendor infrastructure and so forth in your state, the optimal strategy would be to locate a casino in that city.
Okay.
Because there, essentially what you would be doing, you would be recapturing a significant amount of your, what you might call, gambling leakage, and recapturing it in a location where you'd be likely to maximize your multipliers.
Okay. Anybody have any other thoughts on that? So Norton?
I'll just add to not so much a recommendation on that point, but some of the things that a couple of states have done. Ohio has specifically named four cities that can have casinos following this argument, you know, large cities that are adjacent. Kansas also divided the state into four, I believe, and has, you know, you can have a casino in each section, but you can't have more than that. So they're really cognizant of the intrastate yeah. competition, and they're trying to push those things to the borders.
Okay. All right. Any other thoughts on this? So, okay. I also have a question. Do you, I mean, we've seen some sort of slowing down, even though there was a lot of expansion of gambling in the aftermath of the recession in the authorizations of gambling. But last year we've seen some reversals, as you all have been pointing out. Do you think that the 2016 elections are going to have any impact on this issue? So we have certainly had a lot more in the way of a single party, mostly the almost exclusively the Republican Party gaining control. I don't know whether this has been a partisan issue one way or the other, or a regional issue, but do you have any thoughts about whether this is going to have any effect politically?
Well, I know that Nevada, at least, both chambers switched from Republican control to Democratic control, but I don't know if that will have any substantial effect on gambling in that state. I know that Trump proposed or wanted to get into an online gambling venture a few years ago, so yeah. that as far as online gaming in the states go, a federal crackdown may be less likely.
Yes, yes. It's an area near and it used to be near and dear to the president-elect's heart. So, John,
and this is complete speculation, but to the extent that we see perhaps a continued trend in states toward more consumption taxes and less income taxes. Typically, in a lot of states, when you do tax reform, you've got a basket of issues. Not just the singular or dual set of tax policies. So I could see it possible in a state like Alan just described, where it might become a piece of a tax reform package that has that general trend in it, but might be possibly an offsetting element to tax reductions in other areas, particularly when you're, in essence, repatriating some of your funds.
All right, very good. Okay, we have a few questions. So one is, please talk about the increase in gambling of all kinds and the lack of funding to address the public health impacts of gambling addictions, up to 20 people affected by each person addicted. Thank you. Any thoughts on sort of dealing with sort of combining the expansion of gambling with dealing with some of the social costs of gambling? Have states been doing that, or do you want to talk about any of the other, what the research says about the magnitude of the social impacts?
It is common to have a set aside for problem gaming or gambling as a use of the earmarked revenues.
Okay.
Add a short point to that is that actually it's amazing the disparity in terms of researchers, policymakers, whatever, in terms of the assessments of the incidence of problem gambling. And clearly this is a subject about which there's absolutely no consensus about whether it is a major national epidemic, a problem, but not an epidemic, or not a serious problem at all. Yeah. And so it's really, as John mentioned, there are set-asides in many states for programs to address problem gambling. And so I really have no idea whether there is an appropriate balance of resources directed to this relative to the magnitude of the problem. And I'm not sure anybody else does either.
Okay, all right. Any other thoughts? Good. How do you know spending at casinos is only a substitute for other spending that would happen in the state? And what other types of spending have declined as casino spending has gone up in states. So I had a question, too. I don't know if you want to deal with that. Do we, I think Alan may have mentioned at some point that, yes, there may be at the individual household level or individual level, you know, that spending on gambling reduces spending in other areas. Do we know much about what other areas and household spending is affected? So anyway, so what do we know about substitutions or trade-offs in expenditures?
Well, I mean, we have data from Bureau of Economic Analysis, and the data shows that the household spending on discretionary items in general has gone down since the Great Recession. And for the first time, we see Americans saving more and spending less on discretionary items, and that's not just gambling, but any kind of discretionary items, whether it's cars or going to cinemas or any other item.
Very good.
I know there has been research, though again the results vary quite widely, on the displacement of lottery spending by casino spending. And there's a pretty good case that there is significant displacement, though again how much is debatable. I think, I mean, it stands to reason that there are other substitutions going on all over the place, whether it's clothing, groceries, or whatever. But how to, short of identifying a pool of gamblers and doing an intense kind of budget audit of them over time, I'm not quite sure how you'd actually get at what the substitutions actually are.
Okay, I have a related question that maybe Norton can address, the or maybe the rest of you too. The there is this question about whether revenues coming from gambling substitutes or supplements existing spending. One of the, and that usually is talked about in terms of money going to state funds. But if it's going to local governments, do you think the same threat of substitution occurs, or do you think it's more likely to supplement spending at the local government level?
Well, it depends a lot on Alan's chart showing whether the people are coming in from outside or not. If they're coming to a casino as part of their travel entertainment budget, and they're staying somewhere, you know, those lodging tax revenues come in.
Okay.
Dinner, they have to eat, so that kind of revenue comes in. But to the extent that they're not going to the movie theater in Laurel so that they can go to the casino, the revenue from the gaming goes to the state level, but the city will lose the revenue that is on a taxable transaction in the city. However, they usually still eat something. I mean, there are ancillary things, and to the extent one offsets the other, I don't know the answer to that.
Okay. All right, the last one we have is, given the desire to engage millennials, the lines between social gaming and gambling are blurring. Social games and offering in-game gambling or triage to online gambling sites. As this increases, how do you think this will affect the revenue picture, particularly on social games, since social games are not taxed?
Well, I would think that there are some revenue consequences with these new types of games. I don't know about the social, that's referring to daily fantasy sports that are not, that there's no money bet on. But at least there are certain types of games that are taxed less, as far as more, certain casinos are rolling out video table games
to attract millennials, and table games are typically taxed at lower rates than slot machines, usually because you have to provide for things like pit bosses and dealers. But when you're moving to gaming via electronically, states could lose money on that.
Okay. Yeah, North?
I'll just weigh in, too, on a slightly different topic. I think of the tournament gaming that's going on online, where people are actually playing, I'm going to get this wrong, but I'll say Masters of Warcraft or World of Warcraft. There are these games that people are playing, and they're having tournaments at physical locations, and they have huge online followings, and it's only natural that the next thing you'll start seeing is gambling on those games. It may have already happened. I don't know.
Add to that, there actually is it's called skins gaming. There's a game called Counter-Strike where you can actually, it's a shooter game, but you can spend real money to bedazzle a weapon, and then they will bet that on the games. And it's actually a billion-dollar industry through the first half of 2016.
And my guess is there's very little tax revenue coming from it. But I don't know. It may fall under the digital download area, but it'll be really interesting legal questions coming along.
Okay.
Figure out a way to tax it.
All right, folks. Unless somebody has something very brief to say, that we've got, we've had a very good panel. Well, thank you very much, everyone. So, and now our next panel.